And it's a try for the Irish side. Just 2.5 minutes on the clock. A blocked clearance. And a try for Emerald Warriors. Chance now for the fullback to add the extras. 5-0 for Emerald Warriors. Oran Sweeney, the captain, with a chance to put this conversion over. He has a strong wind at his back, and you'd fancy from this position that he should add the extras. Good crowd around the pitch for this, the opening game for the Emerald Warriors. So Sweeney with the chance to tap this over the bar. The kick is good. And Emerald Warriors extend their lead early on in this game. So Warriors, 7 points to the good. As we approach the 4th minute. The Cologne supporters nearby urging their team on, trying to get into this game. They are playing, as I was saying, into a very strong wind and against one of the teams that would be favoured to do very well in this competition, the Warriors. The other teams in this pool, King's Cross thirds and two in. Ball spread out wide, and again it's helped forward by the fullback. Match officials at this Union Cup 2019, provided by the IRFU, who are supporting the officiating of the tournament, and all the match officials with the hashtag on their shirts, try with pride. And certainly there's a lot of pride for the Emerald Warriors as hosts of this tournament. Scrum right down in front of us. Referee not happy with the two front rows. Just having a little word. Yeah, loose head for Cologne, Robert Kieselbaum. A few grey hairs, but been around the block a bit. The Warriors are the team coming into this match with the match experience at this level. Would be fancy to account for Cologne. Carl Goody there, unable to take control of the ball, but the visitors from Germany still have it. Warriors looking to get over that ball and regain possession for the home side. Chance now for Warriors as they go away for a try in the corner. Last ditch tackle can't prevent the try, and it looks like a second try of the game for Emerald Warriors. Over in the corner, well worked score. Driving for the line and getting over for that second try of the match. Looks like it might be Shane Carr who got over for the score there. 12-0 with the conversion to come. And once again, it's going to be the left boot of Oran Sweeney. Nick Heath is still with me here. Nick, already the home side looking in pretty much in control.
Well, it's the sort of statement they're going to want to be making as hosts, isn't it? They'll be pretty pleased with their start.
This is a much more difficult conversion than the first for Oran Sweeney. does have a strong wind behind him. And the flag stay down just to the right of the posts. So it's 12 points to nil. The point I was making about match experience, you know, the Warriors have been around for quite a while now and they've come close in this competition in the past, and I suppose that kind of experience helps.
Yeah, it's certainly going to. We know that the King's Cross Steelers are very much the team to beat with all of their experience on the gay rugby scene, but Emerald Warriors, of course, they've been previous winners of sevens competitions, 2007 in Copenhagen. They picked up the title there. Emerald Warriors, of course, finalists in Bristol in 2013. So they've got the pedigree to go all the way, and they'll be hoping that home advantage can help them get there. We know that, speaking to a couple of the teams, the Steelers, for example, saying some of their good players when I was chatting to them last night, saying a few of them, obviously being teachers, were struggling to get away on time and be part of it this weekend. So you would expect that home advantage would give you the best chance of picking all of those who are available. So they'll certainly be hoping that that's the case for them this weekend.
It is the big question, though, really, isn't it? Having won it six times in a row, King's Cross Steelers, it's going to be hard to stop them, you would feel.
Well, it's strength in depth, isn't it? They bring six teams this weekend, which is quite a statement. Yeah, and so, it will remain to be seen if anybody can knock them off their lofty perch, but they're there to be shot at, and the likes of Manchester Village Spartans, Emerald Warriors in particular, will be two teams that will have a very good go.
The ball is with Cologne on halfway. This is the centre, Kian de Koenig. Ball goes loose though, and it's back on Emerald Warriors' side. Just fighting for clean possession in midfield. Bustling their way towards halfway, but Cologne competing and look like they've got over the ball, but a penalty has been awarded. Going over the top.
The nature of these competitions, of course, we've got to, well, as we noticed in the last game, the Manchester Village Spartans, who had about three number threes on the field, so we were doing our best to get some help from Gareth Longley, who was joining us in co-coms, and we've been given some starting lineups for both of these teams, but they can all swap shirts, which doesn't make it the easiest commentating job, does it?
It does not. It absolutely does not.
But we will do our best for you to keep you updated. There have been a couple of knocks there to the Cologne team. One of the players has left the field, and their number seven seems down in the middle, so they're down a couple here.
Yeah, he took a fairly severe knock there. Rascal Bum is down, and hopefully they'll be able to get over to give him some treatment. He's got his arm aloft there in the centre of the field. He's looking for medical treatment, and I think the referee is just going to maybe have a look now, following that knock on from the Warriors. Chance for him to bring the medics on. All the volunteers this weekend being described as the Pride Tribe. Let's have a look at what happened there in the centre of the field as Bum comes down to make the challenge there. It was just there. I'm not quite sure. It's hard to see exactly what happened to him there, Nick.
May have just planted a foot and got his knee twisted, possibly. Yeah, not the easiest to tell, but was certainly rotated in the challenge.
Yeah, he's hobbling off here. I think you're right. I think it looks like a knee issue, perhaps a groin. So a few casualties for Cologne, because also off is Justus Molitor, the big second row. Who looks like his race might be run as well. Of course, for a team who travelled like Cologne, they wouldn't have perhaps the same strength in depth as some of the other teams. So that's unfortunate for them, just 12 minutes into this opening game.
No sign of the magic sponge either.
No. There is an ice pack, though, on Bohm's knee, so we'll see if that does the trick.
Well, state-of-the-art medical care. I did once commentate on a tennis tournament where they ran on where they ran on with a sponge, a can of beer, and a cigarette to the front row that was down, and he had a go on every single one of them, and he was back to his feet and right as rain in no time.
It is amazing, really, how this competition has grown and grown. When you go back to the first Union Cup back in Montpellier in 2005, you know, seven teams. Now we're here in Dublin with 45 teams. A marvellous atmosphere. There's an amazing, just an amazing esprit de corps. Great bit of crack around the place.
Yeah, that's a brilliant phrase, the esprit de corps. It's certainly very much the feeling. It's a great atmosphere. And we were chatting briefly with Gareth during the first game as well about, you know, the need for LGBT rugby, the need for gay rugby, and it's not necessarily that you need to be going out and playing gay rugby, but it's actually a gay community with a common interest who then want to play the rugby. So it's the sort of community that comes first and then a love of the game that comes second, which promotes, you know, brilliant events like these, and we see teams from all over the world in the Bingham Cup and this, the best of Europe in the Union Cup.
And Cologne are on the attack now, looking to get back into this game. They do trail 12 points to no score. Remember, these halves, 20 minutes per half. So we still have about 6.5 minutes to go in this first half of this game. Breaking down the wing there was Brendan Cullerton with the kick ahead. Good kick ahead, and Sweeney is chasing onto it, but is well covered by the Cologne defence. And a chance for them to clear to touch. Good kick ahead, though, by Cullerton.
Yeah, he just knocked it on, actually, as he tried to clear it away. So it's going to give the Emerald Warriors a decent bit of field position, this.
And that's something, actually, just watching the first match as well, that struck me, that sometimes when you're used to commentating on international rugby or Pro 16, when you see players, amateur players, making, you know, basic mistakes, basic skills, you have to remember that they are amateurs. But that's a poor mistake to make there.
Yeah, absolutely. It also makes you value the great skills at the top of the game. We've seen a couple of crackers already, certainly in game one.
Oh, some amazing tries. Even though Stockholm were beaten, the two tries they scored were both brilliant.
They were great, and Simon Gammon's absolute rampaging run at the start of the second half, received straight from the kickoff. If you've not seen that, get back and watch it.
Vincent Kabongi is over for try number three for the Emerald Warriors. He picked up off the back of the scrum. He's close to the try line, got over really unchallenged. And Kabongi, the vice-captain, with try number three, and already this is looking comfortable for the Warriors.
Yeah, really nice pick, good recognition that he could get on the weaker inside shoulder there and just power his way through. Had the man on the outside that was constantly interesting the last defender, and that was it allowed him the room to get back inside. So nicely done from Kamonga.
17-0, and really already at this point it's hard to see any way back for Cologne in this game, but it's a good confidence booster for the Warriors. They will have bigger fish to fry, I suppose.
Just see the Guinness gates at the back of your picture.
Quite iconic now, actually, that rainbow gate. You know, obviously so famously the Guinness gate has been blacked down through the years, but wonderful in the centre of the city that they painted it in honour of this tournament, and it looks magnificent.
I was absolutely blown away by that gesture. Yeah, absolutely superb. For something so iconic to be displaying the rainbow colours, the freedom flag. Brilliant gesture.
Sweeney is off target once more with the conversion attempt. So it remains 17 points to nil. Of course, Ireland, Nick, you know, with the marriage equality being passed in such big numbers back in 2015, Ireland is a much, much different place than it was maybe a decade ago, maybe, you know, two decades ago.
Yeah, certainly. And you've got generations and younger folk coming through. It's obviously my mother was a Monaghan girl. It's a country with a strong Catholic heritage and faith behind it, and often many people can point to that in various areas of the world as to where religion can perhaps at times thwart the development of equality, but actually, you know, incredible and fantastic to see the support from every corner of Ireland in that marriage equality bill and getting that through. And I think perhaps a few people across Europe and the world were gently surprised by the level of support there was, and it shows how the next generation of people are coming through Ireland with faith, with an understanding that there's absolutely nothing wrong with being gay and that everybody should be equal as well. And it's fantastic to see, and great to see so many numbers turning out here supporting the Union Cup.
Yeah, unfortunately, if you watch the flags around the pitch, there's a good pickup from Kavungi again at the back of that scrum and taking it on in midfield. Gary Lynch up over halfway. Kavungi once more, and he combines with Lynch, who's quick as he bursts towards the line and into the 22. Lynch leaves it there. Warriors looking for try number four already in this game. We'll give them the bonus, of course. Looking to spread it wide again, and a chance in the corner for that number four try. And over and under the posts. It is try number four for Emerald Warriors. Just trying to identify who got over there in the corner. I was making the point that it is a little bit dark here today. The sky's overhead. A little bit grey. It was Sweeney, the captain indeed, who got over for that try. And you can see he was told where to put it, under the post.
Nearly thwarted at the last.
Chance for him to convert his own score now. Really, it is the fourth try. And already, before half-time, the bonus in the bag. And he's chip that one over the bar. The flag's raised, 24 points to nil, and really for Cologne this is damage limitation. Now we saw in the previous match Manchester look very much in control. Some good late tries from Stockholm put a bit of gloss on that scoreline. 24-10 for the Spartans against Stockholm Berserkers, and that looks like it could be it for the first half. And it is the Warriors, four tries in the bag, 24 points to nil against Cologne Crushers. Second half to come very shortly indeed.
Thank you.
The second half just about to get underway at DCU in Dublin. It's the Emerald Warriors playing from right to left in the green colours, and they take on the Cologne Crushers. And already the Warriors in a very comfortable position, the bonus point in the bag, locked up, 24 points to no score, the Irish lead. And here they come on the attack once more, driving towards the line into the Cologne 22, looking to add to the four tries that they already have. Ball is spread out wide there to Kibongo, who was one of the try scorers in the first half, and he's just 5 metres short. This time it's John Toner driving for the line. They've got support there in numbers, and David Matthews looks like he might have sneaked over in the corner for try number five. And really, this is turning into a bit of a rout. You'd have to worry that Cologne Crushers are going to be absolutely crushed by the time the full-time whistle blows in this one, because that is a fifth try already for the Emerald Warriors. And good alert play by David Matthews to spot the gap and go over in the corner. As ever, Oran Sweeney, the captain, is going to convert this time, kicking into a very strong wind, and from out wide, this is a difficult opportunity for the captain. Although I suppose with a lead of 29 points to no score, it's probably not going to matter all that much. He was off target with a couple of his conversion attempts in the first half. Struck it well, but into that strong wind, just not enough. Drops short, and it remains 29-0. For Cologne, though, in this situation, trailing already by five tries, to try and pick themselves up and put up some kind of a performance in the second half is going to be difficult. Clearly playing a stronger team. Great to see, though, you know, a team from Germany over competing here. We've seen a team from Sweden in the first match.
Yes, the truly international flavour of rugby across Europe. And of course, it is fair to say that that these teams, whilst LGBT inclusive, of course, plenty of the straight players in the sides as well. You don't have to be gay or bisexual to be playing in these sides. That's the basis of the communities that form them, but anybody can pitch up and play. So if you are tuning in and you're in any of the areas close to where any of these teams are from, then by all means get in touch with them, get out and have a run. I'm sure they'd love to be adding you to their ranks and getting a little bit more strength in depth.
And certainly the standard of some of the rugby we've seen already, as we see here with this break from the out half. David Matthews, the scorer of the last try, onto Lynch, and he's breaking away into the 22. This looks like, oh, what a chance for another score. Was the ball knocked forward? There it was, and it was spotted by the officials. That was a chance for a sixth try. You can see, though, the burst of speed cutting through the defence, and really so close to another score.
Yeah, Matthews is playing a really good game. Just got his head up, hasn't he? He's spotting where those gaps are, and at the minute Cologne aren't quite sure how to defend it.
Emerald Warriors, of course, who play out of St. Mary's, Templeville Road, founded back in 2003. They're really going from strength to strength. Be great as hosts of this competition to see them do well, and certainly on the basis of the form that they've shown in the early part in this game, they could very well be contenders. Chance now, though, for Cologne to clear their lines. And Nick almost had the opportunity to catch that one, but just a little bit to the right.
I didn't bring my boots this weekend.
They touch judges, of course, with the rainbow flags. So Mark Mulligan makes his way over. Just checking his options here. Quick word there with Philip Purcell. Oh, it's well taken by Purcell. Very well taken in the line-out. And a chance once more for Warriors to spread the ball wide. Cutting through the centre. Oh, that's a really good break by Vincent Kabongo. Under the post. He's done so well for an absolutely tremendous try for Emerald Warriors. And another for Vincent Kabongo. And he did ever so well there.
He's making the highlights reel with this one, isn't he? Brilliant footwork. Gets under. Ball tucked under the right hand. Dots it down. Warriors picking up the start of the second half where they left off the first.
It's very much one-way traffic at the moment. And a chance now for Sweeney to add two more points. And this time he's on front of the posts. You'd have to back him on this occasion. 34-0. And really, we've seen some great rugby from the Warriors in this game, albeit Cologne Crushers struggling really to cope.
Couple for Kabongo now.
Does he get this, Nick?
I reckon.
That was a safe bet, really, wasn't it?
Yeah, thanks. If you can keep them that easy all afternoon.
Cologne, of course, a very young club. They were only founded in 2013, so sometimes it does take a few years to establish and build your player base. And, of course, rugby in Germany would always be secondary, I suppose, to soccer. Football, as they call it. That was well taken again from the restart. Philip Purcell, big tall figure with the scrum cap. And again, they want to get on with it quickly. Noel Novlett there was looking to move the ball quickly, and they do so.
Oh, just going a little too high in those tackles, Cologne. They've got to follow the golden rule of rugby, get around the legs.
It really has been a bit too easy for the Warriors. As they again look to drive forward. Novlett feeds it back once more. Matthews spreading it up over halfway now. Here is Matthews. And again, there's space on that wing if they can get the ball out wide. Cullerton with a little kick ahead. It's gone out of play, but the signs are there once more that Warriors can exploit the gaps.
And you've got to take your opportunities as well, haven't you? Because you never know when these pools get sorted out as to whether there's going to be points difference required. So if you get the feeling that you're able to put the foot on the throat, well, you're going to see a bit of that. And certainly as hosts, Warriors are sensing that they can continue to ratchet up the points here against Cologne.
That may have been, was it crooked in? Or lifting in the line-out? Sure. Again, be another chance for Cologne to clear. Get into the opposition half, maybe. They do have a strong wind at their back, so a chance now to bring the ball into Warriors' territory. And that was a pretty good kick, actually. Looks like the referee is bringing it back. I'm not quite sure what the situation is there.
No, none the wiser myself on that. He's brought it back to the 22, unless the feeling was the ball was taken back.
Well, it's going to be a Warriors line-out. They have been looking for
Purcell in the line. At this time, they've gone towards the back and well taken there by Marcus Connolly.
It's a really good pickup on the floor. Not the quickest, not the easiest pass away. And, well, that's going to be an offside. Player in front of the knock-on picking up the ball. So just a bit of inaccuracy from the Warriors there. Perhaps just so keen to make it happen that they're overplaying a little bit now. Need to just go back to what they were doing in that first half, sticking to safe possession.
I know you were making the point about how important points difference could be at the end of this pool, but I suppose when you have run in six tries as well, there's almost a natural inclination just to take your foot off the pedal a little bit. Concentration levels maybe not quite as high as they would be.
Yeah, or perhaps feel that the tries are going to come easier than they will.
That's Yanto Iwata, the fullback for Cologne. They are into the Warriors half of the field at least. Again, though, a knock on when in an attacking position, and it's those kind of moments that really make it hard to make progress in a game.
Yeah, it's just a lack of basics at the minute from Cologne, which is letting them down, unfortunately. Just a bit of basic pass and catch that they could do with improving on. And I think they're seeing those green shirts coming up in their faces, and that's just taking their eyes off the ball at times and causing those momentary drops in concentration.
So it'll be Noel Novlett with the put in. Good solid scrum from the Warriors there, and again the out half, Matthews looking to get things going. Sweeney was quickly onto it. Cologne have turned it over though, and coming over the halfway line, Robert Mikus. They still have it here. Again though, the pass has dropped. It did go backwards this time, but a basic skill from Cologne that they really could do with, I suppose, working on, because it's something that's causing breakdown in a lot of their attacks. Just Cologne Crushers coach is standing in front of us on the sidelines here, and he's a man that I wouldn't like to face in the front row. He's a burly figure.
Or in a dark alley. He's got a look at one of the Chuckle Brothers about him as well.
This time it's the captain, Ellert. Sets the ball up there. Again, a pass goes astray. Again, it went backwards. So Cologne retained possession, but they've lost 10, 15 metres there. That's the winger, Rosberg. His route was quickly closed down. Ball played back inside now to Thiemann, who's a big second row, big burly figure as well. Not unlike his coach.
Just struggling to make yards past the gain line here, though, aren't they, Cologne? And the Warriors are desperate to put the pressure on and win any turnover that might be forthcoming.
This time it's Frodo Kolm spreading the ball out to the number 20, Sabarel. He's quickly put to ground though, and yeah, just lost it, turned it over.
Lost it in the tackle. Sorry, Con. Yeah, just as he was tackled, trying to pop it up for the support, but Warriors could sense that was coming and got the turnover. But well, now they knock on.
Again, the little chip ahead from Thor. He's chasing after it. Matthews, the covering player, and also there for the Warriors was the tall figure of the number 18. Danger averted for the Irish side, who continue to lead 36 points to nil. And the decision goes.
I think there may have been a player in front of the kick through that.
Once more relief for Cologne as the game heads towards the last 6 minutes.
Those of you watching, it is a straight 20 minute per half clock, so it's not based on injury time.
Those 20 minutes halves does allow the organisers to get through a lot of games in a day, when you bear in mind that there are 45 teams competing in this, in various events at the Union Cup. A lot of organising. They've done a good job of it so far.
Absolutely. Well, if you joined us for the first game, we were able to show you a flavour of the opening ceremony that took place last night here at DCU, Dublin City University.
Did you manage to sample the delights of Dublin last night?
Not too much time last night, but
ever the professional.
Well, indeed, you know. Head down on all that.
I think there is going to be a big party on the Sunday night, though, after the final.
Oh, I dare say there will. No doubt a few will have a scoop or two this evening, I'd say, as well.
That's allowed, I think. Here's Sweeney. Stayed calm as the Cologne players tried to close him down. Maybe a little bit too casual there from the Warriors, who have given the ball away inside their own territory. Just coming back to what I was saying earlier on, they don't have quite the killer instinct maybe that they were showing in the first half. Could be a bit of tiredness creeping in as well, of course. A penalty has been awarded for playing the ball on the ground there, I think, against the Warriors. Cologne looking for their first score of the game and trying to spread the ball wide. This is Yamato Iwata into the 22. Good defensive work, though, from Warriors driving over that ball and then leaving it behind for Cologne to pick up.
It's the closest Cologne have come in a while, isn't it?
I kind of like them to get a score rather than having the duck egg after their first match.
Come on, the boys.
This is T-Man driving forward, the big number four.
Tackle has got to release the man on the floor there, which momentarily might not have done, but this is where Cologne need to get the players in and support. Has come back on their side.
High looping pass there from Thor. And again, the pass isn't collected, but they continue. Cologne spreading the ball out. There are two players out there, but again, another decision goes their way. I think it might have been a high tackle. The referee just telling the Warriors to calm down. Presume they'll go for the corner here. There's a chance to kick at the posts and take the ugly look of that zero off their score. Rafael Thor feeds it back, though. They are looking for that try.
Quite right, too.
Which is absolutely admirable, yeah. And the Crushers just a few metres short now, driving towards that line.
They're going to go route one, aren't they?
Stick it up the jumper. Drive for the line. Of course, from Warriors' point of view, they'd be very keen to keep a clean sheet. And again, just a basic pass, knocked on, not gathered. And the chance goes a-begging.
It's the difficulty with those players looking to arrive at pace, wanting to try and burst their way through. Pass has got to be accurate and an easy one to take. And you could see there, it just was a little high up towards the shoulder. And so there, the knock on.
Not too far away from the hooter to signal the end of this game. 36 points to nil with six tries. I think if you'd offered that to Emerald Warriors at the start of this, they would have bitten your hand off.
Yeah, absolutely.
Is there time for one last score for the hosts? They're going to have to do it from deep if there is.
Well, they've got an awful lot of width out wide here. Sense of a high tackle there.
It was a high tackle on Marcus Connolly, but play continues. And this is Noblet. Good tackle in midfield by the Crushers, but Warriors still have it. If they can keep this ball moving out wide. Sweeney arriving at pace, and Sweeney with a chance to go over in the corner. He feeds it outside, and it's try number 7 for the Emerald Warriors. And really, that rounds off a fine performance by the hosts, but another example there of just taking your chances.
Yeah, comprehensive job done by the Warriors, isn't it? 7 tries.
Get out of the way. It was a very good score, and Sweeney timed his pass outside perfectly for that try.
The number 18 again dotting down right under the post. This will be the last kick of the match. Sweeney with a chance to round it off, and he does just that. 43 points to nil for the Emerald Warriors. 7 tries to nil. A bruising opening game for Cologne Crushers, but from the Emerald Warriors' point of view, this is the perfect start, really, and a winning start for the host team. 43 points to nil. More action to come very shortly.
We're closer. Thank you, sir. Thank you.